Thanks for coming. This is the second speaker event that the Federal Society is putting on this semester. And again, great turnout. Thank you all for showing up. It actually does mean a lot to me and Zach and Brian and Jerry and everybody who helps put these together. Takes a lot of time and effort. So actually just seeing you guys show up means a lot. Today, the topic is ISIS and the AUMF with Charles Cully Stimson. He's a widely recognized expert in national security, homeland security, and crime control. He's a senior legal fellow at the Heritage Foundation since 2007. He became the manager of the National Security Law Program in Heritage's Davis Institute for International Studies in April of 2003 after serving as Heritage's chief of staff for a year. He's written and lectured on policy issues such as military detention and commissions, intelligence and criminal law, including the Patriot Act and FISA, immigration and the war on drugs. As chief of staff to the then Heritage President Edwin J. Faulkner, he was a key advisor on public policy matters as well as a manager of Faulkner's official office staff and Heritage's day-to-day operations. Cully's many research papers, op-eds, and articles include a special report, Adult Time for Adult Crime, Heritage's comprehensive study on the constitutionality of life sentences for teenage murderers. His work on criminal and immigration law has been cited in briefs before the U.S. Supreme Court. Before joining the think tank in 2007, he served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Detainee Affairs under George W. Bush. He advised then Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld and coordinated the Pentagon's global detention policy and operations, including at Guantanamo Bay and in Iraq and Afghanistan. He was chairman of detainee-related panels such as the Defense Senior Leadership Oversight Committee. He represented the United States before the UN in Geneva, Switzerland, and briefed and testified before both houses of Congress. An accomplished trial lawyer, Cully has worked as a prosecutor at the local, state, and federal levels, where he concentrated on violent crimes such as homicide, sexual assault, and domestic violence. He also served as a military prosecutor and defense counsel. He continues to serve with the rank of captain in the United States Navy, as executive officer of the Reserve Trial Judiciary, and as a military trial judge. His thousands of media interviews and appearances include Fox News Channel, MSNBC, CNN, BBC, and NPR. He has been quoted by most major newspapers, including the Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, New York Times, LA Times, and London Times. A businessman and educator by training, he's the vice chairman of his family's real estate company in Seattle. Before joining the Defense Department in 2001, he was vice president at the Global Financial Services and Insurance Brokerage. He holds a law degree from George Mason University School of Law. He's a graduate of Kenyon College and has studied at Harvard and Exeter Universities. He's an avid runner and triathlete, and he serves on the board of the U.S. Soccer Foundation. I had the privilege of working across the hall from Cully and got a lot of opportunities to speak with him, so it's my honor to introduce Cully Stimson.
Well, thank you very much, Drew, and a particular thanks to the Federalist Society for inviting me here to cloudy, soon to be rainy, Syracuse. It's really pretty flying in here over the mountains and the Finger Lakes. I was up here in Ithaca over the summer and vowed to come back. I didn't know it was going to be to Syracuse, so I'm delighted to be here in your new building. What is, just a quick poll, what is the take on the new building? Thumbs up or thumbs down? I saw the old building that too good. And I'm keenly aware of the hot topics on campus, including the speech code, and I want to, or the free speech code, or the not so free speech code. And so I assure you that nobody has vetted my speech, so nobody can be expelled for my speech. And I'm leaving on a plane this afternoon, so I'll expel myself. Drew has asked me to talk about ISIS and an AUMF, and naturally, when Drew asked me to do something, the president heard that, because yesterday during the press conference at the White House, President Obama talked about his three priorities during the lame duck session. And the second priority is, and I'm quoting him, "I'm going to begin engaging Congress over a new authorization to use military force against ISIL. The world needs to know we are united behind this effort, and the men and women of our military deserve our clear and unified support." And he went on after a question. And he says, "With respect to the AUMF, we've already had conversations with members of both parties in Congress, and the idea is to right-size and update whatever authorization Congress provides to suit the current fight rather than previous fights. In 2001, after the heartbreaking tragedy of 9/11, this is the president speaking yesterday, we had a very specific set of missions that we had to conduct, and the AUMF was designed to pursue those missions. With respect to Iraq, we had a very specific AUMF, and of course he's referring to the 2002 Iraq AUMF. Now we have a different type of enemy. Remember him, remember that phrase. It's interesting that he says that as a legal matter. The strategy is different. How we partner with Iraq and other Gulf countries and the international coalition, that has to be structured differently. So it makes sense for us to make sure that the authorization from Congress reflects what we perceive to be not just our strategy over the next 2 or 3 months, but our strategy going forward. And he concludes by saying, and it will be a process of listening to members of Congress as well as us presenting what we think needs to be the set of authorities that we have. And I'm confident we're going to be able to get that done. And that may be just a process of getting us started now. It may carry over into the next Congress. I think it probably will carry over to the next Congress. And so I want to spend some time with you all today sort of walking through as a legal matter, not as a policy matter, not as a policy preference, not as a political matter, ISIS and the AUMF. And I think it's hard, frankly, the day after, you know, the week of the big midterm elections to unpack our political feelings, whether we were for this candidate or against this candidate or for this person or against this person, and go back to our legal nerdy role and talk about the law and talk about what law is required or may be required and whether the current authorities apply to ISIS. So to understand that, and I'm going to actually move this over here, to understand that, you really have to go back to the original AUMF. And I understand from Drew that there are a number of vets here at the school. If you're a vet, please raise your hand. And are you Afghanistan, Iraq?
Both? Afghanistan, but with a German army.
Uh-huh.
I won't get any comments.
Okay. So no doubt if you've served after 9/11, you've served in some capacity, either as part of ISAF or here in the continental United States, that's what CONUS means, under the 2001 AUMF or the 2002 AUMF. Is anyone taking Professor Sales' national security law class right now? Nobody. Yes. Well, Nathan's a friend of mine and a fellow alum from the administration, and I'm sure he teaches a great course. And I'm sure in his course he would go over what the 2001 AUMF is all about. Has anyone here studied AUMFs? Anyone who know what it is? Perfect. I can make it up then. No, just kidding. On September 18th, 2001, Congress passed a joint resolution. And the joint resolution was passed 98-0 in the Senate, and 420 House members passed for it. The only person that didn't vote for it in the House was Barbara Lee, by the way, historical note. And I want to sort of walk through what that is, because you have to understand, as a legal matter, what the current AUMF is all about. And since I'm not debating a person who takes an opposite view of me, I'm going to sort of lay out the arguments of why the current AUMF is sufficient to cover ISIS, and then I'm also going to lay out the strongest arguments of why it's not sufficient as a legal matter to cover ISIS. Now, you know the president says he's going to engage Congress, and I think it's very likely he probably will. This will be one of the things that he will do with the Congress, because the Congress has already moved out on this. So I think that's not just words. I think there's actually going to be some movement on this. And so this will be a hot topic going forward. So I want to lay out the strongest arguments on both sides so you all can make up your own mind. I'm not going to tell you how to think, but I want you to think. In AUMF's authorization for uses of military force, There's the preamble, which lays out the overarching reason why it's there. And then there's the operative text. And the preamble to the 2001 AUMF authorizes the president, no, directs the president to, quote, protect United States citizens both home, at home and abroad. I don't think you think of the AUMF, if you think about it at all, as to protecting U.S. citizens abroad. You really think of it, you know, protecting you guys sitting here, your parents, your loved ones, your people in the city you're from. But the preamble, which is not operative law, directs the president to protect people here and abroad. And I think, in essence, if you look at the debates, they're talking about U.S. soldiers overseas and diplomats and others stationed in post, and U.S. citizens who are working abroad. But listen to the language here of the operative text, because this is where the money is. This is the law. And I'm going to, by a show of hands, see if there are some things in that language that doesn't exist, that should exist, or that comes to mind, why doesn't that exist? All right, and here's what it says. It directs the president to use, quote, all necessary and appropriate force. Remember, this is a week after 9/11. All necessary and appropriate force against those nations, organizations, or persons he determines planned, authorized, committed, or aided the terrorist attacks that occurred on September 11, 2001, or aided the terrorist attacks that occurred on September 11, 2001, or harbored such organizations or persons in order to prevent any future acts of international terrorism against the United States by such nations, organizations, or persons, unquote. What strikes you as that language? Does anything sort of stand out, or is something glaringly not there when you think about the controversies that have popped up since 9/11? Anything? Bueller? Yes.
It mentions attacks against, future attacks against the United States. In terms of ISIL or ISIS, they haven't made a direct threat to the homeland necessarily.
Okay. Two separate issues, but I'm glad you pointed them both out, because we're going to unpack that later. What's your name?
Corey.
Yeah. Okay. Drew.
There's no defined enemy. It's whatever, it's presidential discretion at who is and who isn't the enemy.
Yeah, did everyone hear what Drew said? It doesn't mention the enemy. Doesn't mention the enemy. It just describes the enemy, the people who did this horrible thing, or aided and abetted it, or harbored those who did it. Different than the five declarations of war our country has engaged in, where we named the enemy. All right, we've only declared war five times. The Congress has only declared war five times. There have been dozens and dozens of AUMFs, but only five declarations of war. What else? What does it not mention? Sir, what's your name? Ethan.
An end date.
An end date. Excellent. What else? Yes, ma'am. The scope or action or kinetic activity he can take, correct? Does it mention detention? Does it mention killing? Does it mention droning? To your point, doesn't mention any of those things. It left it very capacious or very broad, and there are reasons for that, and you're going to see that in the discussion today. You're going to see that also in the debates coming up, either during the lame duck or in the new Congress. How has this AUMF been used? The AUMF has been used, most people think, in the context of targeting decisions, droning is the first thing that comes to a lot of people's mind, and detention policy. It's used across a whole wide variety of other activities. Now, who here has taken criminal law? Raise your hand. All right. And in criminal law, you have concepts of due process and a right to a trial and a speedy trial and the Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination, Sixth Amendment right to a speedy trial, Eighth Amendment right prohibition against cruel and unusual punishments, right? The 14th Amendment, due process, equal protection. These are all criminal law contexts. And even if you haven't taken a criminal law, you've seen Law and Order, and you watch crime shows. And so you understand, generally, as an American citizen, and probably one of the reasons that drove you to come to law school, is fairness, justice, a criminal justice system, trials, juries. It's a rich body of law, an ever-developing body of law, and it's completely inapplicable to the law of war. Completely separate and distinct from a whole huge body of law over here called the law of armed conflict and the law of war. And this AUMF that was referenced, no end date, the other things that were said, has nothing to do with criminal law. Zero. And so, and so this tells, this gives the president the authority to use the armed forces to kill people and defeat the enemy. Period. Now, some of the criticism of the AUMF early on in the Bush administration, even today you hear it from some, but not as much, is that, look, this is a blank check. That's what you've always heard. This is a blank check for the Bush administration to conduct the war any way President Bush wants. And then these same groups were just as consistent in criticizing President Obama. He's upped the drone strikes. This is a blank check with no boundaries, endless tyranny and power given to the president, and it's just not fair. It's not the way we should be conducting wars. Well, let's look at the AUMF. First off, and Drew can send around to you, or you can go to the Heritage website and read my testimony before the Senate Armed Services Committee last year on May 16th, the AUMF is actually self-limiting. The language itself is self-limiting. One, the law with respect to the AUMF mentions, doesn't mention that who the enemy is, has been developed through the federal district courts and the Supreme Court to some extent, but much more litigation before the federal district courts and the habeas proceedings in the federal district court in Washington. So the Guantanamo detainees had statutory habeas for a period of time, and then in the Boumediene decision in 2009, it was determined that they had the constitutional right to pursue their cases, constitutional right of habeas corpus to pursue their cases in federal district court. And so the judges have made it all, filled in the gaps, where this AUMF has been rather nebulous in terms of who the enemy is, et cetera. The enemy is, according to the Bush and Obama administrations, Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and associated forces. That's it. It's not every terrorist group out there. It's not every group that threatens the United States. It's Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and associated forces. And that key phrase, associated forces, is the one we're going to hone in on with respect to ISIS, because that's where the money is. That's where the rubber hits the road. All right? The next way it's self-limiting, it's limited by the principle that force to be deployed is to be deployed, quote, in order to prevent any future acts of international terrorism against the United States, unquote. It's in the language of the statute. Now, some people say, well, that's not limited at all, because the president can just say, well, I think they're going to commit future acts of terrorism, so I'm going to go after them. Well, that has not proven to be true. For those of you who serve in the military, if you've ever been in a targeting room, I mean, you know that the target list is limited by who the enemy has been defined by. It's not every terrorist group out there. The next limitation of the AUMF, and this is going to be really important as Congress and the president debate this upcoming AUMF, is it incorporates and is limited by the law of armed conflict, otherwise known as the law of war. Some people call it international humanitarian law, or IHL. Same diff. All right? And there's two basic purposes of the law of armed conflict. Remember, it's not criminal law, where you got to try them or set them free and due process and all the rest of it. It's a completely separate, freestanding body of law. Two purposes. One is the humanitarian purpose it serves, and then as a functional purpose of internet of a law of armed conflict. The humanitarian purposes are three, and I'm gonna go through these quickly because I want to get to the ISIS part. When you think of the law of armed conflict, I think a lot of you would think of the Geneva Conventions, right? I mean, you sort of think, that's it, man, that's the law of armed conflict. That's part of it. Certainly codification in four essentially chapters, but that's not all of it. But the first humanitarian purpose of the law of armed conflict, not this body over here, the law of armed conflict over here, is it protects combatants, and it protects non-combatants from unnecessary suffering. Doesn't mean there's going to be no suffering, because war is crappy. War is imperfect. Nobody likes wars. But you create rules that have incentives so that you protect combatants when they're captured from unnecessary suffering, and you combat you protect non-combatants, you all, except you and you, if you were wearing uniforms, when you're caught up in war. And that happens all the time. The Fourth Geneva Convention in particular is civilians caught up during armed conflict. The second humanitarian purpose of the law of armed conflict is to safeguard persons who fall into the enemy's hands, what I just referenced. The civilian who, for one reason or another, is caught up by the enemy. And you facilitate the restoration of peace. The thinking is that by following the law of armed conflict, and by using these rules effectively, it actually shortens wars, as opposed to open-ended, long wars where you don't have any rules. There's three functional purposes, really, of the law of armed conflict that you have to understand as we get into this AUMF. First is that it assures or ensures good order and discipline. I mean, if you guys are, since you're German, you're the Germans, and you guys are the British, and you're, God forbid, at war, and you are wearing your German uniform, and he's wearing his British uniform, and you're shooting at him, and he's shooting at you, and you're wearing your uniform, you're carrying your arms openly, you're following a distinct chain of command, and you're just a better shot than him, and you shoot him, and you injure him, and you capture him, you're not going to get prosecuted for attempted murder. You're doing your job. You're covered under the law of armed conflict. If, however, you, in direct violation of orders, take your uniform off, dress like you're dressed today, pretend you're a law student, sneak over into England, hang out in London for a little while, and then kill a bunch of civilians, you're not covered with combatant immunity, and you're outside the rule of privilege, and you're not following good order and discipline. Fight in a manner consistent with national law. We have rules in the military. You have rules in the German military. We have rules in the U.S. military, the Uniform Code of Military Justice, among others. And this functional purpose of the law of armed conflicts aligns with and gives you every incentive to follow the rules of your own military, your own country's military. And then it maintains domestic and international public support. If we know that this group, a state actor, is following the rules of war in a conflict, and this group is doing that, domestic support for the war effort, at least in theory, is maintained here and here as well. The next way, the other couple aspects of the AUMF that were noted, one is there's no expiration date. And there's no geographical limitation. Notice it doesn't say where the boundaries are. Now, during the Bush administration, people really hit the Bush administration hard for that, saying this is outrageous. That means you could just drop a drone in downtown London. You can zap people in Berlin if a terrorist, Al-Qaeda member, is walking down the streets in Berlin. You can zap them. Of course, we don't do that. There are all sorts of reasons we don't do that. But then, a couple years ago, 2012, Eric Holder gave a speech at Northwestern University, and he addressed this up front. He said, quote, our legal authority under the AUMF is not limited to the battlefields of Afghanistan. Indeed, neither Congress nor our federal courts have limited the geographic scope of our ability to use force to the current conflict in Afghanistan, unquote. And that's not remarkable because the Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and its affiliates are dispersed. They intentionally move to other places, whether it's Yemen, whether it's the Fatah region of Pakistan, whether it's the Horn of Africa, whether it's Syria, whether they're coming back into Iraq. They're versatile and pliable, and they move around. You find the enemy where the enemy is. Now, now that you sort of understand that part of the main purposes of the AUMF and the unique aspects of that current existing 2001 AUMF, let's get into the ISIS AUMF discussion. Last year, the administration actually said, the president said, he wanted to reform and ultimately repeal the AUMF. And there were a lot of questions in the Congress, especially in the Senate, in front of the Senate Armed Services Committee, about whether that's a good deal, that's a good idea, whether that makes sense. And remember, ISIS is a, well, ISIS or ISIL or IS, pick your flavor, is a relatively new phenomenon, at least in terms of that name. That name, or those three names. But they've been around a decade, at least, in a different form, in a different name. And we'll get into that. But the administration last year, the president himself said he wants to reform and ultimately repeal that. So the Senate Armed Services Committee last year on May 16th had a big hearing. And they had one panel with administration officials, including the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations Low Intensity Conflict, Rich Gross from the Chairman's Legal Counsel, the top lawyer, he's a Brigadier General, for the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and two other important high-ranking Obama administration officials. And they answered the committee's questions. And I want to sort of point out some of the things they said, because you need to hear that, because it will inform you of where we're headed in this debate, because the administration has been on both sides of this issue. Not only have they said they want to repeal it, and now they're relying on it, but they've said inconsistent things between last May and even just a few weeks ago on this. This is hard stuff. I'm not taking the administration to task at all. This is difficult. It's fact-based, by the way. And none of us in this room, even Nathan and me, who still probably have our security clearances, I have mine, I'm not read into these. I'm not getting intelligence reports about who ISIS actually is. So I can't make a definitive assessment based on real-time facts as to whether the AUMF of 2001 specifically covers ISIS or not. I have a gut. I'm not going to tell you what it is. I'm going to play law professor and not show my hand, but I'm going to present both arguments. But last year, here's what they were saying. Last year, well, before I point out some of the things they said, it was very clear. I was in the second panel. We had a panel of civilian experts, and I was in the second panel, and I testified in this hearing. And I was sitting there with Jack Goldsmith, who's a friend of Nathan's, and a bunch of other people who I know, Jeff Korn, professor down at University of South Texas College of Law. And I reminded myself of my Labrador retriever when he's confused. I was doing some of these. Huh? You ever seen a dog when they just go, what? Because I was listening to what they were saying. I'd read their prepared testimony. But then during the question and answer with the senators, I realized they are well beyond what most of us believed the boundaries were or the outer limits of the use of the AUMF in terms of what they're doing and who they're targeting. And so whereas I was very confident, having served in the military and have friends in the military, that they're using it against Al-Qaeda core, Al-Qaeda members, the Taliban, and associated forces, the more the senators asked questions, the more I realized, and Jack Goldsmith did a post on this the next day on Lawfare blog, boy, we had no way of knowing how capacious their interpretation was of how far they could stretch the 2001 AUMF. Let me get the first. Well, look at my notes here. Yeah, the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations Low Intensity Conflict, when asked how long this conflict was going to rage against Islamic extremists, he said that for the next 10 to 20 years. This is the same administration who said we want to repeal the AUMF. And so for an administration that really, at least when they ran for office, felt much more comfortable operating under statutory authority for law of war issues as opposed to pure Article II commander-in-chief authority, it was an odd thing for people to hear that it's going to last 10 to 20 years, but they want the AUMF to go away. And so I testified and said this in part, and you can read my entire testimony if you want, if you're that much of a law nerd, but I'm just going to read what I said in conclusion. All right, I said, and before I said this, I laid out some of the threats that I saw from open source materials, including the fact that there were Al-Qaeda fighters in Syria of who were causing a lot of trouble, and we didn't know where whether they're going to stay in Syria or go elsewhere. And so what I said is this, and I bet a lot of you would have said the same thing. In short, I wasn't referring to my height. In short, the current AUMF should remain in place unless and until the narrow class of persons under its scope no longer poses a substantial threat to our national security. Keeping the current AUMF does not authorize a permanent state of war, as some critics have alleged. It merely retains the legal framework that has worked and served us well to date, and acknowledges that those subject to the AUMF, although greatly diminished in number and efficacy, should not be allowed to regain their footing. In the context of the AUMF, keeping the AUMF as it is does not necessarily mean that the executive branch, this one or the next, will want to or need to employ the full extent of its authority. We cannot foresee with precision when or if the threats posed by those subject to the narrow jurisdiction of the AUMF will be defeated or become so insignificant as to not warrant this particular AUMF. Well, of course, what we've seen since then is the rise of ISIS. And how long is it going to take to defeat ISIS? Don't take Cully Stimson's word for it, because I, again, not read into these programs. I don't know the current security threat. But people in positions of authority and power in the current administration and those who had just left the current administration in those spots said the following. Let me start with the president. That's a good place to start. He should know. He gets the presidential daily brief every day, whether he reads it or not. He said on September 10th that it would, quote, take time to eradicate a cancer like ISIL. Okay, that's generic. Leon Panetta, the former CIA director in SecDef, said, I think we're looking at kind of a 30-year war. David Petraeus, who you all remember who Petraeus was, architect of the surge and then CIA director, says, quote, we're talking about years, many years in the case of Islamic jihadists in Syria. And then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton said in early October this year that the United States and the Islamic State were, quote, in a long-term struggle. So the question becomes, we're going to get into the factual distinctions of who they are as opposed to Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, or associated forces. What authority do we have to confront them, since we know from our top authorities that it's going to last a long time? Any questions, comments, just random thoughts before I pivot to this part? Yes, sir. Your name?
Abdel Rahman Hamid.
Yes.
So in referring to the receiving end of the AUMF, you use the word narrow scope. And I think it's important to be able to know who you're talking about in order to determine how long of a conflict this is going to be. And from your statements, from the statements of the President, Hillary Clinton, General Petraeus, and others, from maybe 30 years, 10 to 20, a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Like you referred to the language of the AUMF as limiting on its own, but as what you followed that with is a very elastic idea of who the enemy is and what time frame is needed for this AUMF to take its effect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So some great points in there. Let's unpack that a little bit. First off, if you're on the receive end of a kinetic activity, a drone strike, or any other, it doesn't seem very narrow to you because your life's over, and those around you, their lives are over, and perhaps civilians that you've surrounded yourselves with or embedded with, they're dead. My point was simply to lay out the factual predicate so far of where we've been, what people have said, as a way to tee up the way to think through an ISIS-specific AUMF. And I started with the president's comments yesterday because I think that's appropriate, because he said we want to right-size it. And if you could wave a wand right now and make the 2001 AUMF go away, what effect do you think that would have on detention operations, drone operations, military operations that are ongoing in Afghanistan? Some legal scholars would say a huge effect, because we would actually have to have a wholesale rethinking of whether we could engage in any of these things. There would be, no doubt, some litigation with respect to the remaining 148 detainees at Gitmo. We have a handful left in Afghanistan, but they're going to go away by the end of the year. But other activities that we take would be severely curtailed in a lot of people's minds. Some would say, well, setting aside Gitmo, which is really the tail wagging the dog anyway, the president can rely on his Article 2 powers and this idea of inherent self-defense, and he can take most of these actions under that and through the Executive Order 12333. That's not the way this president has been thinking. This president has said numerous times that we're on sure footing when he operates, especially in the area of war, when there's express congressional authorization. And I think that's right. But the reason we're having this debate now, and the reason I think Congress is really going to have some different ideas than the administration, and by the way, this is not going to be your neat, typical left-right divide. You're going to have libertarians over here. You're going to have some hawks on the defense, on the Democratic side, over here with the what people characterize as neocons or right-wingers. It's not going to be neat and pretty. It's not like tax policy, where there's a pretty clear divide. Um, But the reason I can't completely answer your question is because we don't know exactly, as the American people, how this administration is applying the AUMF to various groups. We know it's Al-Qaeda. We know it's Al-Qaeda core that's been fairly well decimated. We know it's key elements of the Taliban and associated forces. But how far that associated forces goes out, we don't know. And it's of grave import, not only to the people in those countries where those associated forces exist, but to us as American people, because we're not only paying for our military, but there's an issue related to whether we want to be in a permanent state of war, or whether we can revert back to other models like counterterrorism and other models of protecting ourselves. So I know that's a completely unsatisfactory answer, but it's the best I can do. Who is ISIS? Anyone know?
They began in 2004 in Iraq, and they claimed allegiance to Al Qaeda initially, and then 2008, I believe, or 2010. Al-Zawahiri basically said that they don't want to be associated with them.
Zarqawi was killed in 2006. And then ISIS broke away from Al-Qaeda leadership in 2013. All right. Now, I lay out in greater detail who ISIS is, and if you really want to know more, a lot more about it, you can read Matt Olson, the former director of the National Counterterrorism Center, who was a prosecutor with me in the D.C. U.S. Attorney's Office, in a speech he gave at the Brookings Institution a few weeks ago. And he lays out from A to Z who ISIS is. But let me just hit some of the high notes. They're composed of Sunni Muslims who are drawn to radical Islamic ideology. Most of the members are Iraq and Syrian Arabs. But they've gotten a whole range of foreign militants. We've heard about the Europeans who have flocked there, some Americans, not a lot, but folks from Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Libya, Yemen, and Egypt. Zarqawi founded ISIS in 2004, and as you said, expressed his allegiance to UBL, or Osama bin Laden. And when they were in Iraq, they were called Al-Qaeda in Iraq. Now, they didn't call themselves that. We called them that. They had a much longer name. And if you looked at intel reports or targeting reports, we used their longer name. But then we changed it to Al-Qaeda in Iraq for shorthand. When the surge was successful, they skedaddled and went over to Syria. And so when I was testifying last year before the Senate Armed Services Committee, I was referencing, as some of the press reports were alluding to, Al-Qaeda fighters in Syria. These were the remnants of Al-Qaeda in Iraq. But there was a divorce. There was a rupture in 2013 between Al-Qaeda in Iraq, or ISIS now, and Al-Qaeda Central. In fact, and I can show you how bad this divorce, if you think regular divorces are bad, this one's really bad. ISIS members were engaging in combat with Al-Qaeda's Syrian outfit, the Al-Nusra Front. In other words, they were fighting Al-Qaeda fighters and killing them. So most divorces end in a court battle and, you know, child custody arrangements. This one ends in death. That's a pretty good argument for why the AUMF doesn't cover ISIS at all, because they're not part of Al-Qaeda. And let's just go through those arguments. There's a very robust debate in the legal academy about whether the 2001 AUMF covers ISIS. And the people who think it does not, or think that it's a thin reed to use their language, say that, point to the rupture in 2013. They point to the fact that the AUMF was written in 2001, and Al-Qaeda in Iraq wasn't even created until 2004. So how can that cover that? That's a factual thing that they point out. They also say that even those people over there who say that ISIS falls into the associated force category, they're not, because they're not associated with Al-Qaeda anymore. They're in fact disassociated because of the rupture. And they say that, you know, if we're going to stretch this AUMF so far, here's what you're required to do mentally, is what they're saying. You're required to say that, let's say Drew, mild-mannered law student, is actually Al-Qaeda in Iraq member. And he was there for the rupture in 2013. He's actually engaged in combat operations against Al-Qaeda because he really hates them. And they want to be the big dog. And the argument is that, you know what, Drew, because a long time ago, he used to be part of Al-Qaeda, and now he has nothing to do with it. Anyone who had a nexus with Al-Qaeda is covered by the AUMF. They're saying that's the sort of slippery slope legal reasoning that's dangerous, and why we need an ISIS-specific AUMF. And those are the main arguments. There's some more factual arguments that would be sort of boring for you to hear in terms of various players within ISIS and who did what to whom. But essentially it's that when the AUMF was written in 2001, ISIS didn't even exist. And when it existed in 2004, it was aligned to Al-Qaeda. And when it pulled away from Al-Qaeda in 2013 and started killing them, and saying that their core mission is different, they're really absolutely not covered by the AUMF of 2001. Here's what the supporters say. And let me first say that includes the Obama administration. Because on the day that President Obama gave his speech this fall from the White House on taking up new action against ISIS, a senior administration official said the following on background. Quote, based on ISIL, they call them ISIL, long-standing relationship with Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden, its long history of conducting and continued desire to conduct attacks against U.S. persons and interests, the extensive history of U.S. combat operations against ISIL dating back to the time the group first affiliated with Al-Qaeda in 2004, and ISIL's position, supported by some individual members and factions of Al-Qaeda-aligned groups, that it is the true inheritor of Osama bin Laden's legacy. The president may rely on the 2001 AUMF as statutory authority for the use of force against ISIL, notwithstanding the recent public split between Al-Qaeda senior leadership and ISIL, unquote. That's the administration's legal justification, at least at that time, and that's September, for relying on the 2001 AUMF. They subsequently expanded that by saying that they're also relying on the 2002 AUMF, which of course was the Iraq-specific AUMF. Now, let me point something out to you because I think it's an interesting factoid. In February of this year, two reporters in the Washington Post wrote about how Al-Qaeda's then recent expulsion of ISIS raised questions about whether the AUMF, quote, still applies, unquote, to ISIS. And here's what the article in part says. Quote, according to some administration lawyers and intelligence officials, that's February of this year, the expulsion of ISIS removes the group from the short list of al-Qaeda associates that the president has virtually unlimited powers to strike under the law passed days after September 11, 2001. So the administration itself thought that the divorce took them off being AUMFable, for lack of a better term. That's Jack Goldsmith's term, not mine. But that some, this is the article I'm still reading from it, some in the administration think, quote, ISIS can still be targeted because of its longstanding al-Qaeda ties and parallel ambitions, unquote. So what this proves to me, and it should to you as well, is that there are differences in administrations about key things. There always have been, and there always will be. There were on detention policy issues in the Bush administration, especially early on. There were right through to the end. There are on targeting, there are on drone, there are on interrogation, and clearly there is a split, or at least there was a split in the administration, at least as of February, about whether ISIS was AUMFable under the 2001 AUMF or not because of the divorce. If they don't know, how can you know? Seriously, it's hard. This is tough stuff. So, let's wind this up by looking at what I believe will be the debate, either in the lame duck or in the new Congress, and what the analytical components of an AUMF are going to be. And this is where I think you as law students, people who pay attention to details, hit the books, think about things all the time, have great debates that you're usually not going to have when you have to practice law, so do it now when you're in law school, because you don't play in hypotheticals when you're out of law school. We're not writing on a blank slate here, number one. There have been several proposals already written by members of Congress, or at least analytical frameworks that they've laid out. Senator Kaine's suggested AUMF is the key example I like to use. He said in August of this year, he released a statement. It's on his website, and it says, quote, actions by ISIL over the past several months, including the gruesome murder of an American journalist and threats against others, are barbaric and the work of a callous terrorist organization. I agree that ISIL poses a significant terrorist threat to U.S. interests and partners in the region, which is why the administration has initiated military action against the group. But I do not believe that our expanded military operations against ISIL are covered under the existing authorization from Congress. The 2001 AUMF does not apply, and the administration has testified that the 2002 Iraq war authorization is obsolete and should be repealed. Under Article 2, the president has authority to defend against imminent threats to U.S. national security interests and personnel, but I have reservations regarding whether our military actions against ISIL all meet this test. And then he has a draft AUMF. And Senator Tim Kaine is still a senator. He wasn't up this cycle. His draft AUMF will clearly be part of the discussion. What are the constituent parts, just so we can sort of break it down and understand what these are? And I'll leave you with these few thoughts. I wrote a paper about it. Drew may have emailed it around. I'm sure all of you read it and memorized it, since you don't have enough reading. The first, all AUMFs can be broken down essentially into five analytical parts. One is, and this goes to your question, it's 1, 2, and 3 that are really your concerns. The authorized military resources. What resources is the Congress directing the president to use or allowing the president to use with an authorization? The second is, what are the methods of force? What are the authorized methods of force? Now, you know, to your point earlier, they don't say, you know, you may only use this kind of weapon against this enemy. That's not the way, if you look at historically at AUMFs, they're written. The authorized target, and I think that's where a lot of the debate is going to be. There are some who believe that this should be narrowly tailored and focused directly at ISIL in addition to Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and associated forces. Some go so far as to say only ISIS and keep the 2001 AUMF. I think from the president's statements yesterday, I can't really tell where he's headed. I think in his heart of hearts, which I would be loath to guess, but my guess is that based on all his previous statements, he'd like to see the 2001 repealed and a ISIS, add this group, that group, specific AUMF, but I have no idea. The purpose of the use of force, that's another analytical component, the fourth, and then the timing and procedural restrictions on the use of force. So let's, here's what I have said in generically what an ISIS-specific AUMF should contain. And then I'm going to stop there and open it up for discussion. Before I lay those out, though, typically, if you look at all the previous AUMFs that have been signed by previous presidents, typically the president drafts it, and the president sends it to Congress, and then there's some give and take, sometimes a modification, sometimes very little modifications, and then it's signed. This is a very interesting political dynamic, and let me jump into politics for a second. Remember, last year, there was a request by the administration for an AUMF for Syria, and that failed. And so I think many people believe, and I think the administration off the record would admit, that they feel a little snake bit by that. And they don't want to be putting something out there just to have it batted around and denied by Congress. I don't think that's going to happen. I don't think the Congress is not going to engage on this. I think Congress is eager to engage on this, but they were more eager to get themselves reelected from August on, and that's why the debate hasn't happened. If this was an election year, I think we would already have a new AUMF. I really do. But because it was an election year, they're focused on their number one job, which is to get themselves reelected or defeat the other guy, and that's why this debate has been put off. Here is, I think, what you're going to see in the five constituent parts, and I'm going to crush it down to four because I think it really makes more sense. On the methods and resources, they'll say something like Congress should authorize the use of all necessary and appropriate force. You're not going to see the Congress telling the president he has to tie one hand behind his back in any resource or method. I think what we're going to end up with is leaving the 2001 AUMF in place, perhaps putting a sunset provision on it, and targeting ISIS and any successor organizations from ISIS and nothing more. And I think that will appease the right and the left and libertarians going forward. And they may even sunset that, much like they did some of the FISA provisions, which they've asked to have reauthorized again and again. And Nathan can tell you all about that battle that we all went through. The purpose would be to prevent terrorist attacks by ISIS against the United States, and probably the purpose will also include driving ISIS out of Iraq. They may not include that, it may. And then I think it will include some language requiring the War Powers Resolution, even though all administrations and presidents have considered it to be unconstitutional. I think they'll throw that language in there. There was that language in the 2001 AUMF for reporting purposes. This is cutting edge stuff. This is the stuff that's happening right now. This is the stuff that people on the Hill are talking about. I'm very pleased to be up here to sort of lay that out for you and let you think about it. It's a cool time to be a law student and a new incoming lawyer because there's a lot of tough issues out there. And let me just make a pitch for something totally unrelated to my talk. And that is, if you have the opportunity to do public service, whether it's with the Peace Corps, whether it's Teach for America, whether it's a public defender's office, prosecutor's office, military service, State Department, any way you can put your immense talents and your legal mind to work, do it. You're never going to regret it. You can always go out in the private sector and do something, which is always good too, because that helps pay for a lot of what we get from the government. In fact, that pays for every penny of it. But it's immensely rewarding, and you're going to be able to do things in public service that you're never going to be exposed to from that perspective on the private side. So I want to wish all of you a very successful career. Good luck in getting through Professor Sales' course. I hear he's a tough guy. I'm going to give you my email address. If you want to email me and ask additional questions or just career questions or whatnot, be happy to answer those. It's charles.stimson@heritage.org. Heritage also has a very good internship program that's paid, and you get housing. And for the legal types, you can work in the legal center, and you can participate in moot courts that we do for cases going to the Supreme Court. You can participate in all sorts of cutting-edge legal issues, from property rights to religious liberties to you name it. And so you can ask Drew more about it. He was in the legal center as an intern. So with that, I'm going to stop because I am respectful of your time commitments, questions, comments, or whatnot, and then I'll stay around afterwards if anyone wants to talk to me offline. Sir? Your name, please?
Keeman. What was your fourth point again?
Yeah, the fourth point is that it will inevitably include reporting requirements consistent with the War Powers Resolution. If you look at the 2001 and 2002 AUMF, they have that. I think they'll copy that language wholesale. And I don't think there'll be any debate about that. I don't know if Nathan agrees or disagrees with me, but I don't think that that's going to be the tough part. The tough part is going to be the scope, to your colleague's point over here on the left, and perhaps maybe there's going to be a sunset provision on it as well. Yeah?
Were there any other elected officials?
There are. I just can't remember who they are, but I can get you that list. Yeah. Other questions? Thank you very much for having me.
Just to follow up quick, I'm going to send out another email next time we have an event. We don't have anything scheduled till January, but I am going to try and get Inskit to take us up to the drone base in North Syracuse. Get a tour of the drone base. So if I do nail that down, I'll email it.
Thanks.